Well, this is went off. Still waiting. Can you see my screen, guys? On the Zoom?
Yeah.
On the Zoom? Correct, fine.
Yes, it's visible.
Okay, cool. So let's start. Guys, just come closer in the first row. Yeah. Okay, so I will not use mic, and I will. Is this font size is visible to this audience? Yes. Fine. And I will be using. That's okay. This is also fine, right? My session is about Go tools. So with the Go command, we have a lot of different options through which we can do a lot of stuff. And there are so many options available. We can't cover them all, but I will just go through a few of them so that few of the things which are very useful. So, and I will only go for the overused sort of things. So I will try to cover as many options tools possible. It will be just like an overview. So for the beginner, it will be like new information for them. For the people who already work with Go, for them maybe they are using indirectly, so but they don't know how it is happening behind the scene, like the ID they are using, the ID use those tools. So you may not be having idea, but you may connect those things. But this is mainly about like overview kind of session, and it's like Golang basics. Interrupt me if you have any question along the way. I will be doing a demo directly on the code, so no slides, nothing. Okay, so let's start. So we know this very well. This is like a Go command, fine. So when you run the Go command without any argument, it will give a lot of options that you need to specify something to Go command. So if you see, these are the command I'm talking about. So there are so many commands which you can try it out. These are different commands, different tools, which Go is providing as a language level only, fine. So this is one of the list of the stuff is there. The other thing is that you can see there is something called Go tool. So if you say Go and then put tool, then you will get another list of the tools. So there are few tools which are there in the previous command Go. There are few tools which are new to this one. So this is another list, okay? And then there is a third list where you will say, okay, I want, because these are the standard deliverable from the Go team, but they have also called extension, which it is not like core to the Go, but still like it is like very much near to the Go community, fine? So that you will say, okay, you will get it somewhere here, go get golang.org. So if you fire this command, it will download all the tools which are available in this extension of the language. It is not a standard part of the language, but still it is like, so slowly, slowly, like the tools which can become mature will come to the Go, but they are also kind of mature and we are using day in, day out. Once you fire this command, it will actually put all this tool here in your Go path / pkg bin directory. So these are the tools which are mostly external extension in the X tools package, right? So I already have fired those command, so it is actually downloaded into my laptop. You guys would be now aware of these things. So echo Go. So if I want to say where exactly my Go is running, so it will say that it is actually running from this particular stuff, fine. So this is the bin directory where the Go is installed. So if I just want to ls that bin directory, you can see that with the language there are only three binary coming with along with these things. One is Go, then Go doc, and Go fmt. So Go, we know very well, and GoDoc and GoFMT are another tools. Okay, so these are the different source, different options to find out different tools. So if you just go through all of them, you will find the tools from this Go. If you just write Go, you will get this many tools. Okay, if you write Go tools, you will get this many tools. If you write Go get this extension, you will get this many tools. Okay, these are all tools out of that. So that's it. Like, this is the different way you will find out what are the tools available. You should know that what are the options you have to try it out, and then you can actually, if you require, you can use it for your day-to-day purpose. So now I have this project where I will be working, I will be doing code, and I will be trying to make sure that the tools are used in our demo. Fine. So let's start with these things. So I will just say go run main.go. So this is my hello world application. Fine. But now I want to use some tooling part of this. So the first thing is I want to start with the go env. So this is one of the command. It's not a tool, but a command. So when you fire this one, it will give you the environment of the go. Okay. So it will give a different familiar environment variable. For example, where is my go path? So this is where our old source code will be staying, and we will be building our stuff from this particular one. So if you want to know anything about that, this is go root, where the go is installed. So there are so many things you can find out with this go env command. You can also say, okay, I just want to know a few of them. So just put that two stuff, and it will just give you those two stuff, right? And if you still want to know, so what is this go OS? You don't know, like as a beginner, then you can say go help environment, and it will actually give the information of all the options available. So if I just want to know what is go OS, okay, then this is the operating system for which to compile the code. Example are Linux, Draven, Windows, likewise, fine. So this is one thing. Now I will go for the second stuff, fine. So let me first modify my program. So instead of this, I'll be saying info. Okay, so let me run. So the next things I'm talking is about the module mode. There is a mode command. So Go modules is introduced in 1.11. It is a vast topic. We can't cover it in one lecture itself, one session itself. But I will just give the overview so that you know that why it is there. But then afterwards, you can actually go into the details on your own. So this is overview sort of things. So here you see that I have used some package, which is an external package, fine. So this is a third party package. In this case, I need to actually use this go mode command. So how go mode command work? So before running the go, so if you see my go version, it is currently 1.11.11. So it is 1.11. In the 1.11, the go module is introduced, but it is not by default switched on. So let me just first switch it on. So I can just do it like go 1.11. This is 1.11 module equal to on. So once I do this, now the go module is by default enabled. So if I fire any command, the go module will come into the picture. So if you see that here, only main.go file is there. So I will just say go mode init. So it's just like go mode is the command, mode command, and in mode I have provided the option which is init. So what it will do, it will create one go mode file, which will just say that, okay, this is the module and this is the project where my source code is there. So this main.go is there here. So it will give this first as a module. It is just init, fine. Now I'm going to go build my project. Okay. So as soon as I go build my project, and I so it has not shown any output. Otherwise, if you run it first time, and for example, this particular thing is not there in your system, in your laptop, then it will download it first. Okay, so all the third party library, it will download it into your local laptop automatically. And you see that now the go mode file, it is saying that this is required. So the package which is Logrus, which we are using third party, it is taken directly and populated in the Go mode file. So this is a dependency management system in the Go. Okay, and you guys can now understand that once I have built these things, now if I just deliver my this project, okay, it will use this file to calculate what are the dependencies required, and it will download it from there. And even the I will come to know that on which version I am actually dependent on, so I can control all those things. So this is totally a dependency management. Along with the Go mode, the Go sum is created. This is an auto-generated file, so you no need to modify it anytime. Sometimes you may modify it depending on which version you want to depend, and there are other stuff. But this Go sum file, you will never modify it. It is the Go. It is for the Go internal usage, where they actually put extra information about the dependency kind of stuff. So this is one thing. Yeah. So just to give that hint on that, before there was some third-party dependency management system were there in the Go ecosystem. So the Go language has not provided any dependency management tool as a standard one, standard offering. Fine. Now this is their standard offering after, like, from the Go 1.11. So now people are moving towards Go modules. Before it was DEP. Yeah, because see, any dependency management tool, like if you go with any log, this is my third party log package, fine. If you go with this log or other logger, okay, they will be having log.info, log.debug. It will be a similar. It's just like that. The DEP which you are talking, it's a dependency management tool which is not provided by Go team. And now this is provided by Go team. But any dependency management tool has to have provide the dependency, the version, everything will be same. But this has been implemented in a different way, not only the coding implementation, but they have a different semantics, which you need to dig into more, because this Go module requires a lot of information to go on. But fundamentally, dependency management tool, any tool you take, it will tell them which package you are using, which version you are using. You have to specify these things. Yeah, means so there are so many things, okay, but just try to concentrate there. Now for dependency management, use Go mode, and this is one of the start for the Go mode to use. Then there are so many internal, like vendor directory and all these things are there. This is not part of this particular session. So let's not go into the details. It's just like that the person who does not know Go module at all, he will come to know that, okay, there is something like this. It is used for these things. And there are 2-3 commands, which is like the preliminary command, which you should know to start working with the Go module. And then it is your choice that which tool you want to go. Like these are each of the tool which require like half an hour kind of things. So we are just in one session, we are completely covering some 10 tools. So we are spending some time so that people will get the overview of the different tools. Just try to understand that there is a Go mode tool, which is for the dependency management. There is a history for the dependency management tool in the Go ecosystem, which is a separate thing. Okay? Now moving on, so I just introduced Go mode in it. This is for providing this Go mode, initializing the file. And then after once this is there, if you do Go build, Go run, Go test, automatically this Go mode file will be modified. Okay, behind the scenes, you will never say Go mode build, fine. Okay, you will always say Go build. And for the Go build, they will actually modify the Go mode file behind the scene. Now another, so say for example, you see that in the GoSum file, there are so many things has been put it. Why? Because you can assume that this Logress file, this Logress package would be using some other things in his source, in its source code. So these are their transitive dependencies there, fine. So if you want to list down those transition dependency, you can say this is one of the command. So if you say go list hyphen m all, it will tell you for this, but this is my project, which is using obviously Logress because it is there in my source code, but this Logress would be using all these things. Or somehow when you build my binary out of this particular project, this will be used, and which you will also see in the go mod file. So this is second command with the, which is used with the go modules. Then now I will go to the third command, where go mod y. So you will be wondering that, okay, go list hyphen m all. You will be wondering why this thing is coming into picture. Like you have no idea that why this is coming into the picture, right? Why this is transitive dependency is there. So you can just say that go mod y hyphen m and put it. And it will say that, okay, you have, this is your project, which is using this, which is using this. So in this way, like if you have so many, like you are using Logress, you are using GorillaMux and lot many third party things, but you don't know that for which particular third party library this is used. Okay, you want to analyze those sort of things, then you can go ahead with these things. Now, for example, I want to just put this. Say for example, now I'm not using these things, fine, and I'm just switched to the FMT println. Okay, then this is gone. The dependency here is gone, but the go module file still has the dependency, fine. So what you will be doing, you will be saying go more tidy. So if you do these things, then if you come here, the go mode has removed that dependency. So these are the, you understand now the go mode ecosystem, how to init that one. But then you just start using your, doing your implementation, and when you do go build, it automatically add the dependency. But when you want, when you remove the things, you, if you want to just remove those dependency, you can use this go mod tidy command also, fine. So these are the few commands which I have gone for the go module stuff. Now we will switch to the next two. Hope this is fine. Cool. So let's go ahead. Let's skip this because to make sure that, okay, so if I say go build, it will again bring those things. Into these things, fine. Okay, so now let's go with the next things called, okay, so here I can show you that this is get main.go. So this is like the output file I'm just printing on the console. So I'm now going to modify this file. Okay, and I just make sure that this is like this. I actually change the formatting, and I come out and I let me do the get, and you can see that now this is not aligned properly, fine. Now I will just say go fmt. This is another command, and I will just say, okay, and now let me just get main.go. Now you see that it is totally aligned, fine. So you can see that I just run this command. So before it was like this way, now it has become this way. So this is the formatting things which Go is providing out of box. If you are using some editor, so if I'm using this VS Code editor, if I just try to remove it and if I save it, it automatically applying the Go FMT. So if I change the file from here, I can't demo these things. That's why I use the VI editor. But this sort of things, when you are using an editor, these things, you never come to know that how these. I'm just showing that this is one of the command in the Go ecosystem. And this has made a lot of help to this community. Say for example, in Java, there is nothing like formatter exists. So Eclipse, which is a IDE for Java, it will be having their own formatting. Then IntelliJ is there, they will be having their own formatting. And the source code which is written in Eclipse may not be directly like do the same formatting kind of things. So those things are not there in the Go as a problem. Now I want to go ahead and I want to just write some meaningful function for taking these things further. So I'm writing this is leap year So I keep the example very small and so that we can consider it on the stuff. So I just develop a function called is leap year. Okay. If a year is divisible by 4, then it's a leap year on the basic way. There are some other rules, but for us, this is enough. Now I want to just use this particular function. So let me just go ahead with this flake dot. So I will take the input from the command line, okay, and I will just call this is leap year function for this year. This will be a string, so I need to. So this year is actually a string if you get it from these things. So let me just year is equal to model. So I will just do this go run main.go and I will just pass 2019. Okay, so it's just saying hello world, but okay, I have not saved it. And it is putting year 2019, fine. But this is a string, so I need to convert this string into the integer. So now if I want to know what is the function available, so I come to know that there is a package called strconv. So what I can do here, there is a command called go doc. And I can just say that I want to see strconv. So it will show me the documentation of this particular package, strconv. And this is another way where they will only show, if I say go doc this one, I will just come to know what are the functions available with this one. And I found that there is a function called atio, which take a string and which return an integer. Okay. And now if I want to see the documentation of this one, then it will show me that documentation of ATIO. So this is how you will explore the Go documentation using the command line. So now I will be using this particular thing in my coding. So I will say strconv.atio and I will pass this year, which is a string, and I'm this is like str, and I want this as a year. Okay, and I'm just ignoring the error for now. And then I can just pass these particular things to logress info if is this here, and it is whether it is the answer will be this. So here, and what is the answer is leap year. Okay, so I'm just calling this function with my year, so I can just see now whether this is a leap year or not. It is false, but it is not showing these things properly. You see here, why? Because this particular year is an integer and I'm trying to print as a string. Okay, so if I want to know that what is the problem here, then there is something called go wet main.go. So it will actually, this is like a tool which will actually tell all this kind of so go when you do go build, it is still compiling. See, if you do go build, the program is still compiling, but when you run it, you will realize that there is something wrong with this program 2019. So you can say that this is not looking good, fine, something is wrong. So what is the problem? Because we have used modulo s, which is a wrong format for the integer. So if you want to know that what is the problem, then you can go with this tool called go wet. It will tell you that okay, info f format modulo s has a argument year of wrong type int. So it is saying that the year is int and you use modulo s. So to get these things rid of, you need to make modulo d. And if you now run the Go Wet tool, then it looks fine for Go Wet. Okay. And now if you run your program, then it will print, is 2090 a leap year? False. Okay. And now let's pass this 2020, which is a leap year, which is true. So Go Wet is another thing which we have covered.
So Wet, we can consider it as lint in CRC++, right?
Yeah. So Golang is another tool. So I'm coming to Golang. Okay. So there is something called Golang also. So when you do Golang, so this is another tool. Golang, it will give you some more things. That exported function is leap year should have comment or be exported, unexported. So it is showing that you have this is leap year, which is a public function, and you should provide a comment to that particular function so that the user of this function in the future can understand, because there will not be any source code fine all the time. So that is where the Golang is coming into the picture. So if you say easily, I will say that this is a check whether given year is year or not. Okay, so let me just see whether it is fine. So Golang still say there is some problem. What is the problem? They want that it should start with is leap year. So this is some convention which in the Go community very common. So you can say is leap year. This is the function. It checks whether given year is a leap year or not. Now you try with Golang. Now it is fine. So this is how like Go Wet and Golang. So if you do, if you have a compilation error, the Go build will tell. Okay. Like if you are assigning integer to a string. Now if you are not doing those sort of mistake, but if you are doing something where the language will not behave correctly, then Go Wet will give you. That is called static analyzer tool. Okay, it will tell that. Like say for example, you are returning a statement which is never getting executed, and if you want to know that in your big source code what are those statements which is never going to get executed in any condition, in any sequence flow, then the Go Wet is one of the thing which tell you that this is the one will never work. Golang is for like this kind of convention that okay, provide the proper comment and kind of things. Okay, hope this is clear on the Zoom.
Yes.
Yeah. So let's go ahead and let's go with some more tools. So there are so many tools. I just got lost. Which tool to talk now? So let me just go with the Go tools called list. So list. Okay. So say for example, when I say Go build, okay, it is doing something fine. What it is doing, if you see, it is actually putting something called Go tools here. Let me remove this Go tools. So Go tools is my current project name. So whenever you run Go build, it will create a binary with the Go tools because that is the root. If you want to change the name of the binary, okay, so let me remove this Go tools. And if you want to change the name of the binary, you can say O out and out as a leap year. Okay, earlier. And now you say LS, it is your earlier. Okay. And now you can run this earlier and you can pass 2020 and it will say whether it is there or not. So this is another thing. Like with the Go build, if you want to output with some particular name, but we will go beyond than that. So if you see LS hyphen LA, okay, you will see that this is okay. This is the executable in the Linux system. Okay, so this X is there. And it has C3249074-71. Now, Go is also providing that you can actually create an executable of any operating system which Go is supporting. So say for example, you want to create the executable for the Windows. So how you will do, you need to say Go OS. You remember this is like Go OS is one of the environment variable, say Windows. And then you need to say Go Arch equal to MD64. So you want to go with the 64-bit operating system. And then you go as usual and you will say that L here for .exe fine, because this is for the Windows. So it is creating, now do LS LA. Now you can see that this L here which was created for the Linux, okay? And it has different size. And this is exe, which is created, which has a different size. Okay. I can execute L here and I can just pass 2000. But when I try to execute earlier dot exe, and if I pass this, it will say that it cannot execute the binary, exe format error. Okay, so you can't execute exe of the Windows on the Linux system. But this is how you will create these things. In your Jenkins job, you can just create the by output of anyone, whichever you want to like. Whether it is Jenkins is running on Linux or Windows, doesn't matter. Now, I want to know that I want to create for the macOS, and I don't know what is this Go OS for these things. And what should I do? Go tool. This is for the distribution. What are the distribution? And list is all the distribution, list it out. So I can, okay, come to know that there is Darwin is there. Okay, this is for the macOS. So I will just go, same command, and I will just put Darwin. Okay, and it has now created for the macOS, the executable one. It you can't run this also, but the size will be different. You can see that the size of all of three is different, right? So this is one of the Go features which providing to create binary for any operating system. I'm running on the Linux, fine, but I can create on any operating system for any operating system. So next things, okay. So when I'm doing this Go build, okay, there is, so this Go tool, I actually shown you in the initially that it has different other tools also, fine. So you need to provide another tool. So there is a tool for compile. So Go tool compile. So if you go with a Go tool compile, it has a lot of other options. These are compiler level optimization you want to do, for example. So we will try to understand what are those things. So say, for example, you want to do Go build. And this is how you will provide the compiler level so when you run this command, you can see that I'm just building this particular project, but I provided this I say Go tool compile. So Go tool compile provide different options, so I have used one of the option, fine. Go tool compile, so it is providing some option call. So I think this is the way you will, when you are building, you can directly provide it. That this tool you can use independently also, but I'm using with the build. So this is how you can provide this particular GC flex. So when I put hyphen M, it will show me that how this particular code is going to be compiled, the compiler level instruction. So it is saying that this is leap year is, can is leap year be a inline? So can you make this function as an inline function? So if you make the function as an inline, then the code of that function will directly expand it at the point of the call. So you no need to make a function call. If you make a function call, then it will go to the stack. The function will go to the stack and it will do the heap management and everything. So it is saying that if is a leap year can be inline, and you will find that this is leap year is actually they have put the inline also. Fine. So if you want to see, so if you put hyphen M, you will get one level of things. If you go hyphen M, you will get two level of things. So this is like two level of logging on these things. And you will come to know that this inline, our isLine function is actually inline. See, you see here, the function is actually expanded here itself. Okay. So you need to understand these things later on, but this is the way you can actually understand how the compilation is working. And you, if you want to make sure that I don't want to do inlining, okay, then what you can do, you can say that hyphen M L, and this will disable the inlining. Now you compare this outcome. So this the second output is with inline. It has so many lines, and this is without inline, which has few lines. So the inline is disabled within this flag. So now in your compilation output, none of the function will make as an inline. Okay. See, these are the things which you may not be using on a day-to-day, but these are the things sometimes for the optimization you will come to know that, okay, I want to go with inline. I don't want to go with inline. Going with inline is a better thing because it will actually make the thing faster for your stuff. But let me just see what is the impact this is make. So if I say this is, so I will remove all L here, star, okay. So I'm saying this is one, and I'm saying this is two, and let me see. Okay, so the binary size is still same, fine. Whether you will go with inline or not inline, the size of your binary will stay still same. So this is one of the things. There is also called go tool called link. So there are two phases always. Once you have source code, once it is compiled, then later on it is linked. And then the final output binary will come into the picture. If you know, like the we have learned this into the fundamental when we were learning the computer basics, right? So there is this go tool called link. Okay, so this is for the linking of the purpose. So let's see how we can use this tool, fine. So for example, this is my PR tool. And I want to provide version. Okay. What is the version of my this tool? Okay. So I'm coming how we can use this linking, fine. Okay. See, you see that this is providing some problem. So it is saying that this is the exported variable, which should have a comment. And this is provided by Golang facility in this particular editor. So if you provide this comment, version, it will actually stop blaming, but you need to specify something more. So anything. So this will stop complaining. Golang will not complain anymore, even though because that is enough for it. And what is the problem? I think this should do. Okay. So now I'm talking about go tool link. How to use this? So when you do go build, you can actually pass this parameter called ldflex is equal to hyphen x main dot version, I think is equal to 0.0.1, and then you will say output equal to L here. So now if you run this program, so I have just created L here, so I will just run L here and I will pass 2000. You can see that while I'm doing this, I use this link parameter which will allow me to pass main dot version. So this is my main module, main package. It has a variable called version. So I can tell that main.version, the value will be 001. Okay. And I just printed these things and it is automatically come here. So say for example, let me remove all these things. So I will make it 002. And now let me run these things. And it will source 002. So this is the linker kind of facilities where you can actually provide this variable value outside of the program. You are initializing a variable outside of the program. See, there is no code in this program which still tells that version equal to XYZ, version equal to the past string, fine. If you see this particular one, we are like, if you are passing the year as the argument, you are taking that year and you are assigning it here, fine. But in case of version, we are not doing anything. This is the linker which will do these things. So whenever you are releasing your stuff, and if you just want your version to be incremented by one, you can actually use this facility. People generally keep one version file, a text file where they will keep 001. Now they are releasing another version, then they will modify it to 002, submit to their repo, and from there they will fetch it. If you don't want to do that, you can do like this way. See, my point is not about it is really useful. It is how there are compile stuff, Go tools, which you can use. I've just shown you one thing, that hyphen n. Here I have only shown you the hyphen x, okay? But then later on you can go and you can actually go into the details. There is one more thing in this stuff where you can show hyphen s and hyphen m. So now let me just, so I have created a layer and now I will create a layer 2. So there are now two, a layer 1, a layer and a layer 2 binary I have created. When I created a layer, I have actually kept this, I have not provided this argument. When I created a layer 2, I have provided this argument. Now let me just show the difference in the file size. So you see the file size for the earlier, which is the same program, it is some more than these things. So when you provide this particular flag, at the linker time, they will not put the debugging information. So you can't debug this executable later on. But so these are the kind of optimization. So if you are actually delivering your Go program to a mobile devices, say for example, you are putting into some IoT where you have very less memory, like in the SIM card, if you are providing this stuff, fine, then you want to go with this option where you remove this debug information and your binary outcome will be less. So instead of 5 KB of these things, it will become 3 KB, for example, and it is useful in that way, fine. So this is another tool which we have visited so far. So far, good. Any question? Okay, so let's go for the next one. I will take some more time, Praveen. Fine, just stop me. Another 15-20 minutes. Okay, so stop me whenever, because these are like so many things. We can go slowly, slowly later on also. So let me go a little faster also, and I copy paste the code which I, so we are now going to the next set of tools. So for example, I will not sort on the content, but I will just copy paste the stuff. No issue. So I have this. Okay, so I just want to write some test cases for these things. So I've already written previously. So let me just copy paste it. Okay, so now these are, we are going with the tool which are related to test, right? So this is how you will write your test program. So now I just extracted this easlib here into a separate file. Okay, that's it. And I this is called libyear, and this is libyear underscore test. So all the tests which you are writing will go to libyear underscore test file. So I've written two tests, one is true, one is false. So if you pass 2016, it will return true because it is divisible by 4. If you pass 2019, it will not. And how I should run it? So there is a tool called go test. So this is one of the command, not a tool. Okay. And you will just say, okay, run it. So it is running a test. And the test is run. Now I don't know what has happened. So I can just go into the details with hyphen V. It is a verbose mode. So it will say that, okay, it is true and false, two tests are run, kind of things. So let me run it once again. And now you will see that when this run with the hyphen V first time, it has actually said it took this much second. But later on it says that it is cached. So the Go is actually doing this caching. So if you are not changing anything, it will directly take it from there, from the cached. And it will make the things faster. So say for example, you have 100 test cases and you run it, 99 were successful, one was failed. Now you fix only one of them, the last one. And now if you run the Go test once again, it will only run one, the 99, the things it will face from the case. But you are not fine with that. You want to make sure, no, please take it, remove the case. And you can, there is something called Go clean. Okay, you can use this one. This is another command. Test case. Now if you run these things, it will again, don't use the case. Got it? Okay. There is another way where you will, you don't want to do with this, because it happens that if you remove the get, if you clean this get case, test case, it will clean test case for every other project, fine. So if you have like, you are working on 5 different Go project, and if you run this one, it will remove the case for all these things. But you don't want to do that. Still, you want to make sure that when you run these things, it should not be get from the case. Then what you can say, count is equal to 1. So it will actually run it once without from the case. You can see it is not from the case. So without clearing the case, we can run these things. This is like a side. The count is not meant for this, but you can use count equal to 1 for doing that. If you use count equal to 2, then all the tests will be run twice. You can see that this is run once, run second time. Okay. So count usefulness was for that things, but you have used it for this. This you will do this count equal to 1, 2, 5 times. So sometimes it happens that if you have a race condition. So in the first time, if you have a complex thing where there is a race condition, so first time the go, the things will get executed properly, but the second time may not, right? Because it depends on the race condition how it get executed. So sometimes you will use these things also. I think, yeah. And then there is something called fail fast. So say for example, you have written a wrong test. Okay. And now if you are running go test dot hyphen V, so even this true, the first test was actually failed. The second test was executed. But if you don't want to do that, then you can say fail fast. So you will realize that when this true, which was having a problem, the other one, the false one, was not executed at all. It was not run. The test was not run. So if you have 100 tests and your 51 test is failed, then rest of 49 tests will not be run at all. It is like fail fast kind of things. Otherwise, it will always run. So when you by default, if you go with the go test, it will always run all the tests, irrelevant of the test are failing also. Fine. It will not stop there. So this is one more thing. So if you want to know that where this case is getting stored, so I told you there is environment, fine. So if you go with this one, if you say this one, you will come to know that the case are getting stored here, fine. So you can go and check it out where how it looks like. So if you go to that particular folder, if you do ls, these are the go case, fine, the file for the go case. Now so let me go back to my folder. I will say go clean CSCHE. Okay. I want to clean every case. There is a test case, there is a build case. I want to clean all the case. So I clean all the case of Go. And now I went to that case folder where the case are actually located. If I do ls, it is actually removed. Okay. So again, if I just run something, cd this will get me to the previous directory. If I use go build, okay. And if I again go to my this directory, if I do ls, again the case will come. So likewise, hope you are following, fine. So I will just go to this. So the tools test stuff is sort of done. Now I want to go with the next things where I want to enhance my this function, fine. See this is leap year, I want to add some more condition. So it is now more sophisticated where it is taking a lot of stuff, and the same thing I'm calling from my test. Okay. And I want now I need a different stuff, fine. So for example, I want to know that my this Go test, how much things it is covering, fine. Because if I run my Go test, this is still running, fine. I need to change this guy. So it is still running. I want to see this, what is cover, means how much thing is cover. So it shows that there is a coverage of 50%. Okay. So my test case is actually covering 50% of my code. But this much information is not enough. Like what code is covered, what code is not covered. That is also important, fine. Then you will, so we go with cover, we will need to go with cover profile. And we need to give this profile cover.out, okay? So now I'm running and I can see there is a cover.out file is created for me, fine. So let me just go tool cover. So there is a Go tool called cover. See, I use, so a Go tool cover, it has these things. I have used cover profile to create the coverage data. But if I want to process that data has the information. If I want to say get cover.out, this is the file I created. It shows that, okay, what are the things is covered, what are the things is not covered. But this is in the text format. I want to do in a visualization. Then there is a core tool, cover tool, and I can just provide HTML and I can provide my cover.out. So this will actually, if you see, it will start my, it start a web browser and it will open and show that what are the things cover and what are the things not cover. So we have enhanced our this logic and it say that is here is modulo 4 is always cover because it is green, but the rest of the things like this condition is not covered, this condition is not covered. So I need to pass something which is satisfied this condition. So if I add a test in my these things, so I can add one more test, fine here. Okay. And I can say, okay, 1600 here. And now let me run these things once more. So my test is running one more time with the cover profile. So let me run this go test cover profile is equal to cover.out.-v. Remove this hyphen v for now. So now my coverage is increased because I added new test. But now what is that tool cover HTML is equal to cover.out. So if you see that now, this condition is actually now covered. Okay, if you see, compare the previous one where this was not covered. So this was the previous one, this is the new one. So now you will come to know that how it is done, fine. Now I want to know one more things where there is something called cover profile and there is something called cover mod equal to count. So I am adding some more stuff. So I have added, it is not, I have not added any test cases, fine, new, but I have just come with cover mod equal to count. And now if I want to run the tool and see now, if you compare the one with the previous one, you can see that this green is darker, this green is lighter, and this green is even lighter. So it shows that how many times this particular condition is run. So you have covered the code, but how many times, like how many times particular statement is covered in the count basis. So it will show that the lower the coverage, it will show in the gray. If you go to the higher coverage, it will become the green. So this is the lowest, this is covered. Red is not covered, gray is covered, but this is covered more than the gray one. Okay. Another 5 minutes. Okay. So this is one thing. Now, what else I will go with? Yeah, I mean, so here you can also say go. If you say function, then it will tell each of the function how many time it is called. So this is leap year, not how many times, but it will show how much each of these things it cover. Fine. At the function level, you can see the coverage. Now coming back to this. Okay, the one last thing is the bench sort of things. So I think I will cover in 5 to 10 minutes. I have the code ready, so I will just copy it. So for time being, I'm just removing all the tests which I have written, just commenting, and I'm just bringing something which is for the benchmark. Okay, so Go provides something called benchmark facility. Benchmark is like how fast or how performant your code is, right? So for example, I've written a function which say whether this is a odd number or even number, right? And if you provide call that function, it takes 1 second to tell. It takes 2 seconds to tell, for example, right? So if it is taking 2 seconds and if you want to make it 1 second, then how you will process those things? So something called batch is there. So for all the tests, it should start with the test prefix. For all the benchmark, you do start with the benchmark. And then you will get this particular as an input by default from the Go. So this B, you can have B.N, and it will be one value, which will the benchmark tool will provide. So let's just go ahead and see what is happening. And then I will explain. So this is running the, this is doing the benchmarking. What it is saying that when you pass this n equal to this much count, and if you are this is leap year, okay. So this is, this particular value is the value of this n, b dot n. So for loop, we are calling this particular things. So you can't call a function once and you can find it out what is the performance. You need to call it multiple times to find out the benchmarking. So this is how it will do. So Go has called this function this many times, and it has found average time to run this function is this much nanosecond. So this is taking 50.52 nanosecond per operation. Okay. So this is with the bench.
But since we are using the same input,
yeah. Yeah. So there is no casing happen because our logic is not casing anything. Fine. It is our logic. No, Go won't do the optimize because it does not know what value you will pass, fine. It is like dynamism. You can actually modify the, you can sometimes put 2019, sometimes 2020. You can modify this benchmarking. It is your wish. But for this basic benchmarking, this is how to interpret the benchmark data, fine. So you can go with the bench mem. So, okay, if you go without bench mem, you will find a difference. So without bench mem, you will not see this particular things. So with bench mem, you will say that how many allocation is happening, memory allocation is happening. In our case, there is no memory allocation is happening. Otherwise, it's so that per operation, if I'm creating one string with a star, fine, pointer, then the allocation will happen. So it will be one allocation per operation. Okay, and if I'm using a string of one character, then if it is taking like 32 bytes, so it will show 32 bytes per operation kind of things. So you will also come to know that how memory utilization is happening with this particular thing. Now the last thing, so you can also say, so this is like you can say bench time is equal to 2 seconds. So my run my benchmark for 2 seconds. You will see that instead of 2, it become 3. So now Go has actually run it for at least 2 seconds. Okay. So Go will run it for at least 1 second to understand the behavior of your program under benching. Minimum 1 second, it can go more. Once the Go will confidence that this benchmarking looks makes sense, it will actually stop. You can also force to be restricted to 2 seconds. 5 seconds or 10 seconds, depending on your whatever the stuff you are using. or you can go with this count. So it will run the benchmark for 3 times. 1, 2, 3. Fine. And you will see what is the average of these things. Okay. Now you can actually, there is a tool called bench compare something. There is something called bench compare. Okay. So you can take the output of your this particular one into first.txt. Okay. So this is like your first time bench you are running. Now you modified your this particular one and you said it, okay, I don't want to check all these things. I don't want to check these things. Okay. I don't want to validate this. Okay. I don't want to do any validation. I made changes in my program and I run it once again. So I say second. So this is, I'm running it for the second time. Okay, sorry. This way. So I'm running it for the second time. So now I have two first.txt and two second.txt, and I can go with bench compare and I can just put first, second, and it will show that the comparison. So the old one, which is like first, it took this many nanosecond per operation, but the second one, which is the latest one, it took little less because we have removed some logic. And how much gain we have got is 25% performance gain. Got it? Yeah. So I think I have one last thing, which is profiling, but I think I can stop here where I just wanted to show some, okay, let me run this guy. So there is something called profiling. So with the bench, you can also go with the profiling and then you can do this. I will just go very fast. So it will show that, okay, how your stuff is actually, how which, but it is giving the visualization set, how the tree, the call is happening and how much each call is taking time. The first two, if you see, it is for the benchmarking. Okay. The last one is the one which is actually benchmark leap year. It is the one which we have created. You see, this is the one which we have created, but you see that there is, we are calling is leap year, but it is not coming here at all. You know, you observe these things, is leap year is not coming at all. Is leap year is getting called. Why it is not coming? Because the Go has made this as an inline. So our is leap year become inline for this particular benchmark leap year. So the all the overhead of the is leap year is now as a part of benchmark leap year, and which is wrong, which we don't want to do. Then what we can do when we are running these things? So I have run this thing to create this CPU profile. At that time, I can pass that flag, if you remember. And I can disable this inlining with a hyphen L. Fine. So now my bench is running without allowing inlining. Okay. And now let me just see what is happened. Now you will see that the other function is also coming. So easily leap year has also come and then validate has also come. You understand this difference in lining? Okay. And now you will come to know that is leap year is actually taking some 75% of your time. Validate is taking this much time. This is CPU profiling. CPU profiling is what? CPU time. How much my program when it is running? My program is only running for 1 second. Out of 1 second, how much CPU, how much time my this particular function call is leap year to? And if I want to find the CPU bottleneck, so I find that my CPU is going 100% for 5 minutes, then I can run the CPU profiling for that 5 minutes and I can understand which function is taking time. And then I will go to the coding of that one and will try to rectify the issue.
I have a question.
I
have a question. So is there any restriction on the size of the function that is being inlined? For example, in C++, we say it should not be recursive and all those things. Yeah. So is it the same here or entire function will get inlined here?
See, at least this is leap year is getting inline. Okay. So it is good. Means I don't know, like if you make it more and more bigger, it may not be inline later. I don't know the logic of when it actually goes stops, go takes decision whether you want to make it inline or not. But yeah, there is a one thing. And you from the CPU profiling, you can actually go with different things. So this is like different way to see how to understand these things. So it is just showing different way, like flame graph. See, you can just explore these things. The point is that when you actually have a CPU problem, you need to use this way. Okay. There are different, there are so many things, like how to do CPU profiling for the web application. So this is not a web application. So there are ways to do. It is using the similar mechanism, but the command which you run will be different. So I think I'm done with my stuff. Any question, we will take it. Any question, anybody?
So I have a question about the multi-platform planning. So we saw that how we can use the OS and apps plan to build a specific for that. So can we build like a cross-platform planning?
Yeah, that's what we did, fine.
Cross-platform means that there will be just one planning if you can run one platform.
No, that will not be, because the Go will actually compile to the native. So in Go, there is nothing like JVM, which is there like VM. There is no notion of VM. Okay. So the Go, when you compile and when the final outcome come, it will be like, you can take that one and you can directly put into the Linux where there is no Go install. There is nothing installed. Okay. You can take, if you take the binary of Android, you can just put into the Android where nothing related to Go is installed, but the binary itself is a Androidify. So you can't have a one binary which run on different platform. Even for the Linux 32 and 64, you need to generate a different binary because the variable length, like integer size, will be different in 32 and 64. Any other?
Regarding igniting, I just like to say that there's a budget of 80. That the question was asking that if you exceed the budget of 80,
yes,
then the function will not get it.
Yeah. Yeah. So if the things when we run this GC stuff, when we run these things, okay, at the time if you go to this two level, it will actually show that okay, it is not able to make these things inline. So if you see, this is the things, this is the budget he is talking about. So let me copy these things, and let me put it here. So it shows that. The main function cannot be inline. It is too complex. It has a cost 406 and it is exceeding the budget of 80. So this is the way, but how it is calculating this budget, I don't know. But with this particular compilation stress test, you come to know that why the function is inline or not too inline. These are like compiler level optimization. Cool? That's what. Okay, guys. Thanks. I will stop sharing. Yeah, on Zoom, a person who is connected from Zoom, they can just post the question in the text and I will try to answer it directly. Thanks, guys. Yeah. Yeah, so there are a lot of tools which are not covered. It's like 25% of the tool. But I've shown you how to find which are the tools available. And then it is your wish that whenever you're stuck into something, first find whether there is a tool available.
I got the cable, but we need to put up in here. No, no, we need to put it here. There's no VGA here.
There's no VGA here.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, no, I don't have HDMI.
They have converter.
It's VGA.
I've already connected on Zoom.
And this here.
This one won't.
He'll
Hello everyone. First of all, I'd like to take a moment to thank Praveen and Ankur for organizing this, and also thank you everyone for waking up early on a Saturday morning. I'd like to make this as interactive as possible. If any time you have any questions or doubts, or I'm going too fast, please feel free to stop me. My name is Agniva. I'm a software engineer at FTL Tech, and you can find me on GitHub at this handle. So our topic is common patterns for Boundscheck elimination. We'll start off with explaining what are Boundscheck, and then we'll take a quick peek under the hood of what actually happens when a compiler inserts a Boundscheck. And then before we move on to some common patterns applied throughout the standard library to remove Boundscheck, we'll just take a look at some of the things to keep in mind before we apply this pattern. And lastly, we will apply all of the things, patterns that we learned into a real world code, and we'll see the improvements that we get. Okay, so what are Boundschecks? Put simply, they are the cause of this, which I'm sure all of you have seen. So in a nutshell, that essentially means that for every A of I, the compiler will insert a check to verify whether 0 is less than or equal to I, less than length of A. That means that everywhere in your code, every time you do an array access, slice access, you have to pay the price of an if condition, which is the compiler needs to verify whether the I is within bounds of the length of the array or not. And this can be quite painful for performance sensitive apps, right? Because why do I need to pay the price of a Boundscheck when I know that the code that I write will be always within bounds, right? So for example, if I have a loop which goes from the I goes from 0 to less than length of A, and I'm accessing AI inside, right? So that means I know that AI will be always within bound. So why does the compiler need to insert a check, and then because every time it runs, the compiler will do the check, which will hurt performance. Okay, so that the question comes as, do we really need a Boundscheck? Can a program function without it? Sure, C++ doesn't have Boundscheck, and they are very fast. But C++ puts a trust on the programmer, which means that it trusts the programmer to do the right thing. But we programmers are only humans. How many times do we do the right thing? So I'll give you an example. How many of you in your entire time of writing Go code has never encountered this error? Not even once. That's what I thought. So yeah, we programmers, we make mistakes. Right? So the C++ philosophy is that, okay, go fast, do whatever you like, but there are risks. If you're writing good code, fine code, and everything is fine, but if you make a mistake even once, the effects will be disastrous. Like if you have this out of bounds exception in C++, segmentation fault is the least of your worries. There will be buffer overflows and whole lot of, like, there are a lot of tools, exploits, which take this exact out of bounds exception to cause hacks and other things, right? So I'll just give a quick quote by Charles Hoard in his 1980 Turing Awards lecture, where he's talking about Algol 60, which is a Boundscheck language. So I'll just read out the quote. Many years later, we asked our customers whether they wished us to provide an option to switch off these checks in the interest of efficiency on production runs. Unanimously, they urged us not to. They already knew how frequently subscript errors occur on production runs, where failure to detect them could be disastrous. I note with fear and horror that even in 1980, language designers and users have not learned this lesson. In any respectable branch of engineering, failure to observe such elementary precautions would have long been against the law. So then what do we do? Do we sacrifice performance and have safety always, following Charles Hoard? Or do we have a lot of performance and give away safety? Can we have both? That is, we are having safety and at the same time, there are no bounds. Turns out we can. So we let the compiler do the heavy lifting. So the compiler analyzes the code and removes Boundscheck where it can prove that the index is within the bounds. So this was the example that I was talking earlier, that there is a loop where I is going from 0 to less than n, right? And we are accessing a of I here. So the compiler will analyze this code and it will prove that, oh, okay, AI is going from 0 to less than length of A. That means there is no need to put a bound check here. So here we are getting the the advantages of both. The compiler is doing the checking whether bound check is needed or not. And then when it can prove that there is no need of a bound check, it removes the bound check. That means there are no bound check, there is no price to pay, everything is fast. But when it can see that, okay, I need to put a bound check here, and then it's putting the bound check. So, okay, this case is fine, but what about this case where I is going from 0 to 4 and we are accessing the I here. Here, the compiler doesn't know the length of A. So it doesn't know whether A of I will be an out of bounds exception or not. So here the bound check is needed. But we, the programmer, we know that it has to be within bound check because that is the reason we're writing the code. We obviously don't want to write incorrect code. So in these cases, we can provide a hint to the compiler for them to understand that, oh, okay, wait, this is within bounds. So if it gets that hint, then it will remove the bounds. So in the upcoming slides, we'll take a look at some of these hints, some of the various kinds of hints that we can provide to the compiler. These are the patterns that are found throughout the standard library. So we'll take a look at what we can do to remove these bounds. But first of all, before doing anything, we need to measure. We need to understand what the compiler is seeing, right? So if we take a look at the code here, then we might think that, okay, I don't know whether the compiler is able to prove or not. It's just a guess. I don't know. So this is the way to know, right? So as Nurali showed earlier, so GC flags you need to pass, and then there's this magic string. Don't ask me how this string happened. This is how the compiler designers thought they want to. So dash D means the debug flags for the compiler, and SSA is your face, key, and then you have a value string where check BC is the SSA face, and BC means bound check elimination, and debug one leg, first level of debug logs. So if you have like that loop in the previous slide, save it into foo.go. Run this, or alternatively, you can just invoke the compiler also. So then you don't have to type GC flags, it does the same thing. So if you do that, you will see lines like this: found is in bounds, or if it is a like a deslicing thing, you will see found is slicing bounds. So if you see, and these means line 26 and line 48. So when you see these, this means that the compiler is inserting a bound check. That means you know that, okay, a bound check is being inserted here, and when we provide the hints for the compiler to remove the bound check, these lines should go away. Okay, so before we go into some of the patterns, we'll just take a very quick look under the hood of what is actually happening when the compiler is inserting a bound check. Right, so I talked about, okay, the compiler wants to check whether I is within like greater than equal to zero and less than length of your node. Right? Let's see how the compiler actually does this. Okay, so here is some sample code where we are passing a byte slice and an n, and we are setting v of n as 9. Right, so here the compiler has no idea whether the length of v is greater than equal to n or not. So the compiler has to insert a bound check. Right? So what we'll do is we'll take a look at the assembly representation of this function by doing go to compile dash s will give the assembly. And then we'll see what is actually happening. Right, so this is the assembly for that function. I have color coded the lines. So red is 3, like first line, green is bn equal to 9. And blue is the last ending. I'm not going to go into details of what all of this means. I don't know what everything means. I'll just go into which part the Boundscheck is happening, and then which part that actually the assignment of 9 is happening. So let's go line by line. Here n plus 40, it is moving to n. That means n plus 40 is n, that parameter n we are passing. So this line just means I am not explaining what these lines are. Okay, so this line means that ax is equal to n. Then we are moving b plus 24 to cx. So this line means cx equal to length b. So one thing to keep in mind is that you probably know that when a byte slice is being passed, the entire slice is never actually passed. The slice header is passed. Slice header is just a struct which has three attributes. First is the pointer to the underlying array. Second is the length of the slice. Third is the cap of the slice. So b plus 24, it just means that 24 bytes from the top of the stack will point to the length of the slice. So cx is equal to length, right? Then we are doing a CMPQ of AXCX. This means that CMPQ and JCC, this essentially means that we are comparing AX and CX, and then we will jump to 45. JCC 45, this is 45. So here is where the Boundscheck is happening. So CMPQ essentially does a subtraction. It subtracts len B from N and then checks whether the value is greater than or equal to 0 or not. So if n is greater than or equal to length of b, that means it's an error, right? So in this case, it goes to 45, runtime parity increase. So this will cause that an equal. So let's take a quick example. Let's say that if n is 5 and slice length is 10, right? So 5 minus 10 will be negative, everything is fine, there will be no issues. And if n is 11, 11 minus 10 is positive, it will go to panic. But one case which, I mean, I was stuck here trying to understand what's happening. You can see that it never checks if n is positive or not, right? Because n is integer, we can pass n as negative. So let's say length of b is 10, and if we pass n as minus 2, so minus 2 minus 10, it will be negative. It will continue as usual, right? So what's the catch here? The catch is that while doing these comparisons, it is converting n and length of b. You can see that u thing here. U means it is converting both of them to their unsigned representation. Now the optimization is that if you convert a negative number to its unsigned counterpart, it will be larger than any signed integer. So that means if n is negative, so if in the case of if n was minus 2 and length is 10, so it will do unsigned of minus 2 minus 10, because unsigned of a positive will always be positive, and then minus 2 will become a huge number, larger than even any signed integer. Then it becomes positive, it will go to panic. So this is a optimization wherein like you don't have to check two things, you are just checking one thing by converting it into answer. Okay, so this is essentially what the Boundscheck is doing. It will insert these mock queue, CMPQ, and GCC. These three instructions are the price you have to pay for every Boundscheck. After that, it's the same thing. So B plus 16, so B plus 24 was the 24 bytes from the top of the stack pointing to the length. B plus 16 is the pointer to the underlying array storage. Then we are moving 9 to C of CX we stored as the star B. So we are getting the address of CX, offsetting it by AX. AX was N, which is 9. So B of N, we are storing 9 to B of N. Any questions? Right? So this is essentially what a Boundscheck is. That's all. I'm not going into anything else. Okay. Last things before we move on to the patterns are some things to keep in mind. So use these patterns only to squeeze the last drop of performance from your app. Sometimes shaving of a millisecond may or may not matter for your code. Always focus on writing clean and clear code first and then come to optimization, because writing these hints will make your code look a bit weird and odd. So a junior developer might come and think that, okay, why is this line here? This line is not doing anything. Then let me remove this line, thinking that, oh, I'm doing some optimization. Whereas they actually remove that optimization. So yeah, be aware of that. And as usual, with great power comes great responsibility. Don't shoot yourself in the foot. Use this judiciously. And always, always benchmark your code. Do not fly blind. That is, after removing a bounce check, don't think that, oh, okay, now the bounce check is gone, my code is faster. No, don't assume. Benchmark your code, see if there is an improvement, then you know that, okay, now my code is faster. And refer to Dave Cheney's performance workshop on how to run reliable benchmarks. I'm not going to go into details on that. And last but most important is always check against the latest Go version, because the Go compiler is being consistently improved. So some hints that we are providing currently, the compiler might be smart enough to understand those and remove the bounce check by itself. So we might not need to provide those hints at that time. So it's good to always keep checking against the latest Go version. Okay, enough of theory, enough of warnings. Now let's look at.
Yeah. For example,
if you require
Go 112.11.
Correct. And Go 112 does not require that hint.
Right. So remove that hint.
But I first need to benchmark with Go 112, then remove the hint.
And then
no, I'm not talking about benchmarking here. So you're talking about
the
compiler improvement, right?
So how would I model out of 5 hints I have given? Now this 2 hints I'm going to use because it's a Go 112,
then. Right, with that check DC, that DC flags, that thing, no? So what you need to do is you need to remove all of those hints. Okay, now you can see that, okay, whether the compiler by itself is removing those hints or not, right?
So it's like when you go one by one. Manually,
I mean,
yeah,
one
by one.
Correct.
Like you locate that, okay, this hint is no one in there. Yeah, it's one by one.
I mean, it is manual, right? I mean, how else can you automate that?
No, I'm just asking. Correct. Go provider saying that, okay, now this hint is redundant. Because.
Oh, okay, that way. No, because the compiler will just say that the bounce check is there or not.
Yeah.
You need to compare whether Go 11 removes that bounce check, now Go 1 or 2, I mean, what kind of thing. Right, good. Okay. Right, so we'll go through some common patterns. Right, so this was the first pattern where I was talking about, where I is going from 0 to less than n, and we are doing a B of I. Right, so here if you do this Go tool compile, so by the way, SCD is the full string, I just shortened it for lack of space. So if you run this, put it into foo.go and run that command, you will see that line 5 has this found is in bounds. So this means that, okay, the loop will go n times, it has to check whether I is within bounds or not. Now, what can we do to provide a hint to the compiler that B of I will always be within bounds? Because as a programmer, obviously n has to be within bounds, otherwise there's no point writing the code. We do something like this. So this means that the compiler will do a dummy access at B of n. This is outside the loop. And then it will go from 0 to n. Here the compiler knows that, oh, okay, wait, I'm doing a bounce check for B of n here. And after this, inside my loop, everything is from 0 to less than n. So that means if Bn has a bounce check, B of 0 to less than n does not need a bounce, right? Because it's already taken care of by this case. And if I do a Go tool compile, it will say that the bounce check has moved to line 2. So this is what we call as hoisting the bounce check out of the loop. So essentially what has happened is, instead of n bounce check, where n is the number of times the loop is running, we are doing just a one bounce. Is that clear?
Yeah, but if I have been asked that, okay, I need to go at this end,
I would rather go with I is less equal to len of B. This is the normal.
No, no, no. We are not going to len of B, right? We are going to N. N is different than length of B.
Okay.
You getting it? So length of B can be 10, 100, anything. N is something else. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Obviously, if it is length of B, then the compiler will automatically recognize that it is length of B, so then it will remove the marks. Right? But okay. That's it. No, no, no. So you're right. Yeah, you're right. Correct. It's a mistake. But yeah. Okay. So okay, this is another common pattern in the found in the standard library, especially in the encoding binary package. You'll see patterns like this, where you are passing a byte slice and you are setting values like B0, B0, B1, B2, B3, setting some values. Okay. Now, if we run the command, we'll see that line 5, 6, 7, 8, all of these lines have a boundscheck. Okay. So, can anyone guess what is the hint that we can provide? Yeah. So what Ankur is saying is that we'll just do a B3. So we are giving a hint that, okay, B3, just check B3 here. And because all of this is within bounds of B3, the compiler will remove the bounds. So the all of the bounds chip 5, 6, 7, 8 got changed to 4. Okay. There is also another way you can do this is by reversing the order of these assignments. If you do B3, B2, B1, B0, then the compiler is the same. The compiler is okay, B3 is here, then I don't need to check for the rest, but it's a weird way of writing code. So these are the things that I'm talking about, like see how the code is, think, okay, whether this is readable or not readable or whatever, and whether if it is worth doing this optimization, that is the main thing. And then go ahead and. Okay, so this is also another common pattern where you're doing the same thing as before, but the slice axis is offset from basic. So here we are doing. We are passing another integer n, and we are doing n plus 0, n plus 1 like this. Same as before, all of these bound checks are happening. Anybody wants to guess what we can do? Underscore b n plus 5. Yeah, let's try it out. So, okay, I have something like this. Okay, now, okay. Bound checker dot go. Fine. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We are getting bound check. Now B N plus 5. Okay. Let's see. Please. So in this case, the compiler is unable to detect and apply this optimization. Just how the compiler works. Any more guesses? Sorry? Yeah, that's fine. I'm saying that what can we do to remove the bounds here?
In the previous example, it just works.
Sorry?
In the previous example.
This one, yeah, there's no variable here, right? So, yeah, anybody? Sorry, I'm not able to hear you. Get the byte slice, okay, and then?
There are two ways you can eliminate
you give the size of the pipes, right?
Okay.
And actually, forward to the size of the longest pipe.
Can you just tell me what do I need to? Yeah. Yeah.
What is the length of the pipes?
Okay. Okay. This is the length. Then what do I do? Sorry, I'm just come over and tell me now. Oh, okay, okay, got it. This is what you're saying.
This is simply.
Yeah, just write it in. Okay.
Okay, there are two ways. I hope this works.
Yeah, yeah, we'll try it. So here you are just doing a re-slice.
Yes.
Okay.
Right now.
Yeah.
That way we will play with the.
Okay.
This.
So keep in mind that this is n.
Yeah.
That has no relation with length of v. Okay. So this the compiler already knows that. I mean, v of length of v, no. So something has to be with
yeah,
n.
N will compare n with the length of v.
Yeah. How can we do that?
We can try.
Yeah. We can try. Robin, is this
no,
like,
no.
Am I exceeding time or something?
No.
Okay. Yeah, what are you asking?
What about maximum?
Maximum of?
Maximum.
Okay, what do you want to do? Try to access of. But then, oh, but that's not necessary, right? Because, I mean, n has no relation with max of n. Like, we are unnecessarily checking whether, okay. Okay, okay. So what we do here is that this is the case, right? We do a reslicing, but we are do a reslice from n to n plus. So note that here we are only accessing from n to n plus 5, not that side of like not like n minus something or n plus 6. So what we need to do is we just need to let the compiler know that the length of b will be always within that range. So we do a reslicing here. We take from n to n plus 5, that is like exclusive. We assign the same. So this is actually reslicing, and then we are doing b0 to b5. This is exactly the same thing, but what is different in this case is that length of b is known to the compiler because length of b is from n to n plus 6, which is length of b is 5, sorry 6, and so the compiler knows that b0 to b5, if length of b is 6, there is no need to bounce. So like same way as before, the bounce check has moved to line 4.
Okay.
And if why?
If the b is size of 10.
Yeah. So if the code is incorrect, obviously it will panic. That is obviously given.
No, it's, I can't give it incorrect like this where it may result to panic. That's okay. So if
here also your code will panic anyways, right? I mean, I'm, if n is
this will not panic. Okay, you are
saying. Okay. Yeah. So the first assumption is that code is right. Okay. So this is also another pattern where we are ranging the slice of A, but we are accessing BI and CI. So here A of I, there won't be any bounce check because it is just the compiler knows that it is within length, within range, but the compiler doesn't know about BI and CI. So same like line 11, we have two bounce check. It's same as before. We are just doing a hint. where we are requesting the bounce it out. Oh, I think this, there should be a bounce check here. This output is wrong. So yeah, once this is done, the bounce check are removed. And lastly, there's an honorable mention of eliminating the bounce check if the slice range can be derived. Okay. So here, take a look at the code here. We are passing a byte slice, and we are passing a slice of int32s, and we are ranging the byte slice, right? So T means T will be a byte, right? And we are doing an H of T. So if T is a byte, what can be the range of T? 0 to 255, because it's a byte, right? So can we do anything here? Same as before. Since we know that T will be 0 to 255, we know that we don't need anything beyond that 255 range, right? So we are again just doing a reslice of H to like colon 256, and then we are using H below that. Here the compiler knows the, now knows the length of H, right? It knows that, okay, it is from 0 to 255. And it knows that, okay, T is a byte. So again, the bounce check gets pasted to line 4. So yeah, these are some of the patterns that we have seen. So it depends, right? It depends. It depends on, I mean, it depends on your use case. If you are writing some application which needs to be as fast as possible, day-to-day code. Not in the code that I like write to get paid, because that is like that does a lot of things. Oh, but this level of performance is not needed. But I'll just show you in my demo exercise. So I have a library where I've applied these patterns and got it. Right? And also like in the standard library also, if you find patterns like this, then you can optimize, right? Correct. Right. So in the standard library, in the crypto library, you will see a lot of patterns like this. Crypto, image, JPEG, encoding, JSON. JSON has a lot of optimizations where the bounce check are removed, and encoding binary, a lot of this. Correct, correct.
How much overhead
you are able to do? We'll just see. Again, so all of it depends on the compiler version, other factors that your code is doing. So best way is to always benchmark and see. We'll just see here. Last, what is it?
Next.
Correct. Exactly. So that's how the compiler knows that, okay, if this is within bounds, it proves that the rest of them will be always within bounds, so no bounds. Okay. So. I don't know about other languages. But in Go, in the Go standard library, these are simple.
But they
write
the
Should I zoom in more? So this is a library that I had, which calculates the Levenshtein distance of two strings. And I had made this library some time back, and I didn't bother about Boundscheck or anything. So initially I just focused on, okay, whether the code is right or not, everything is working perfectly or not. So recently I came back to this library and said that, oh wait, so there are so many Boundscheck, we can remove this. Right? Levenshtein distance is like, okay, so let's say that if you, while doing like any Google search or anything, if you entered a wrong word which has a like slight spelling mistake by one, right? One E became I, something like that. Then Google recommends that, did you mean this, right? So how does it do that? So essentially Levenshtein distance between two strings will give you how close two strings are, right? If you write snow, S-N-O-W and S-N-O, then the Levenshtein distance will be very small, like one. But if you're comparing Levenshtein and Frankenstein, Levenshtein distance will be bigger. So that is how the closeness, similarity between two words are. So what Google will do is usually it will take a word, and if it sees that, okay, there is no dictionary word matching this, it will compare this word with all the dictionary words there. The word which has the least Levenshtein distance with this word means that, okay, maybe the user meant this word, right? So that's what this library does. Okay, so let's apply some of the things that we have learned to remove the Boundscheck here. I won't go into like the details of the algorithm. We'll just focus on some loops, some indices, and see how we can remove the Boundscheck. So first things first, we will run this, and we will see what are the Boundscheck that are. So we can see there are 7 Boundscheck, okay? And line 47 is here. And then 58, 60, all of these are just indices of X. So anywhere XJ minus 1, XJ minus 1, XJ, plus 1, x len, all of these are having Boundscheck, right? So now let's look into removing. Let's see how much we can remove and optimize this. And then we'll obviously do a benchmark and we'll compare that whether the performance has indeed improved or not. So first, let's focus on this loop, right? So this loop, we are creating a slice of integers, len s1 plus 1. And we are iterating from 0 to less than equal to len s1. And we are accessing x of y. So here the compiler is unable to say that, okay, if it is going from 0 to less than equal to len s1, and so it does not know whether length of x is what has the relation of len s1 with length of x. But we know that length of x is actually more than len s1. So less than equal to len s1 is essentially iterating the entire slice, but the compiler doesn't know that. So any guesses into what we can do? So this is the fix. So this is the same thing as before, but this is iterating to length of less than length of x. Now the compiler is, oh, okay, it is going from 0 to less than length of x. Now I can remove the Boundscheck. But wait, first we will verify. Okay, so line 47 is now gone. Okay, we have this. So one down, 6 more to go. Let's see. Okay, now we will come here. Right. So, we have one Boundscheck, line 58, 60. So we have one Boundscheck here. So x of j minus 1, x of j minus 1 here, and x of j, and again x of j. So in this loop, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, where we are accessing x of j minus 1 and x of j. And same as before, instead of going from 0 to length of s1, less than equal to length of s1, we are going from 1 to less than equal to len s1. And same as before, the compiler doesn't know that len s1 is actually equal to length of x, so it gives a Boundscheck. So what we can do? same thing, right? Okay. Let's do that. Length of x, and let's see. Great. Okay. So we are down to 3. But note that there is something interesting here. Here there was no line 57. We have now a new bounce check at line 57. Let's check what happened. Line 57 turns out to be this one. S1 of J minus 1. S1 was a string. S1 is a slice of runes. So now S1 J minus 1. Now J is going from 1 to length of less than length of X. Before it was going from 1 to less than equal to len S1. And len S1 was the length of the S1 size. That time the compiler knew that, S1 of J minus 1 will be always within bounds because it is going from 1 to less than equal to length of S1. Now it is going to less than length of X. So it is removing the bound check of X, but again it is putting the bound check of S1. S1. Because
157, what is the column?
20, right? Yeah, which is? This is 21, so yeah, this one. And logically, that also makes sense, right? Because we know that J is the one which is iterating, that one is I, right? So we got rid of 4 bound set, but we added 1 more bound set, right? And we still have X of len S1 here. So, anybody? Sorry? Okay, where? Here? Yeah, right. Okay. Sorry. It's off. This one, right? And then len of S1. This is what we're saying, right? Okay. Correct. Absolutely correct. And right. Okay. Now let's see. Cool. We are down to 2. Let's see. 54 is there, which is the hint, and 67. So 67 is out of this outer loop. So let's move it up. None. Good. So we came down from 7 to just 1. Now this bounce check, there's no way to remove this as of now. I filed a compiler issue where this is happening. So the reason this is happening is because the when you initialize the slice here, what Ankur was talking about, that the slice is actually, using that SSA optimization, the slice is actually lowered to a very close to assembly-like representation, where this information that length of X is actually len of S1 is lost. So hence the compiler is unable to make this deduce this. So this is the price that we need to pay. Okay. So now let's see that. Okay, we have removed 6 bound shape. We have just now 1 bound shape. Let's see if we have any performance improvement. So this is the commit that I have pushed. So you can see that, comparing different strings from different languages like ASCII, French, all this. And you can see that on an average, I'm getting 20% improvement, right? So by just changing 2 lines, we have got, I'm done. Yeah. Oh, maximize. That is only 5 minutes. Yeah. Okay. So yeah, by just changing two statements, we have got around 20% improvement. And this actually made this library the fastest Levenshtein distance library in Go. So here I have benchmarked with other libraries. The top two other Levenshtein distance libraries were from Demian Whiskey and Arbovian. So you can see that since I have removed the bounce check, it's now faster than all of these. So yeah, these are some of the things that you can apply. Just so just keep in mind that okay, your port can indeed look odd, and depending on your use case, whether if it is worth doing these optimizations or not, then by all means go ahead. So yeah, that's all I have. Thank you. And lastly, one more thing, that if anybody of you is interested into contributing in Go and want to get started, then I'm happy to organize workshops and like to show you what are the things that you need to set up and like what is the review process, how does review happens, and how your code gets checked in and all that. So let me know if you're interested. Thank you. Sorry? Yeah. So this command, no? This one? Go tool compile dash s. Right. So if you, this was my Levenshtein.go, right? If you dash s. That was capital S. So this is the assembly representation of that. And one thing to keep in mind is that this is not the real assembly that gets executed. This is like a abstracted form of assembly, like a pseudo assembly, wherein the instructions are not exactly the same that gets mapped into the real hardware. There's another layer which finally translates these instructions into the actual. No, that happens. The Go compile itself does it. Yeah, compile itself does it. The compile dash s output shows you the Go flavor of the assembly. But when you can do an OBG dump of your binary and you can see the difference. So for example, this one. So JCC, right? So JCC, there is no real assembly instruction JCC. When it gets actually compiled to assembly, it becomes JAE, jump above or equal to. But JCC is just like a generic thing which this go tool compile dash s generates, so like jump condition check. So.
Like
your
library, how do you know which is the critical amount?
You profile it. First see that. First, don't think of bounce check. First, think that, okay, this is the profiling. First, simple optimization. Whether I can do some improvements in algorithms, first, whether I can reduce the memory or not. Like bounce check is very, very specific genre of optimization where you are optimizing bounds, right? So first, after profiling, after doing all things, you see that, okay, now bounds check is the one I need to remove. Those hot functions, because that's where it will count, right? That's where it will give you the bang for the buck, that okay, since this function is getting executed so many times, if I remove the bounce from that function, that is giving me real benefit. If you remove bounce from that function, from some function which is executing like 100 times, you won't get any practical benefit, right? So first profile, see what are the hot functions.
Profile is like running the test.
Yeah, actually, they picked him about that in the performance. He himself forgot that he had an eventual decision that way. Oh, wait, I have that. I don't know how is it possible to know everything about everything.
Hey, to people on the call, we'll be starting the next session at 12:45.
Thank you. like.
Basically looking, but that's what it's scheduled.
And Praveen, after that, what do I do? I just do share this thing, huh?
Yeah, just share.
Just share. This is fine. Leave the mic unmuted, yeah. Are we good? Okay, so that's a history of it. So hopefully today's talk is way more straightforward. Like I said, in the previous thing, what all I had covered was things like starting off with basic testing, why we do testing so that code is correct, why we do benchmarking and how we do benchmarking so that we check for the speed of particular pieces of code. We look for coverage companies like, you know, there are certain companies that I've worked with also, they have very strict coverage requirements. Before you check in code, the code has to have so much coverage. There's another company that I had done some consulting for where they don't even use external libraries unless they have like a 95% coverage, right? So something like Logress. I don't know if you guys have used Logress for logging, they wouldn't use it because it doesn't have the requisite amount of coverage that is required for them. So that's good. We looked at benchmarking, we looked at profiling. Profiling, we basically to say, you know, how do we instrument code to see how fast is it run? Is there any way to improve it? We also looked at things like GoTorch. I know Nurali showed you GoTorch. If you you didn't show that, right? GoTorch is a very interesting tool where it allows you to also see a graphical view of how your code is running and which are the parts that are taking the maximum amount of time. Yeah? So it's you based on the pprof that you generate as part of benchmark, you can run it through the Torch thing to show you a UI with a graph, right? Which says which are the functions that we probably should be optimizing. We also looked at how the actual Go routines are scheduled inside the Go runtime as opposed to how threads are done in most other systems. And therefore, why you need to have a certain amount of understanding of the internals to actually make it work better when it comes to Go. Tracing looked at not just optimizing one piece of code, but in tracing, we've seen how we look at latency. It's not in benchmarking, we look at one function and see how much time does this particular function take, and then we try to optimize it. Profiling mostly look at this entire set of calls. How is it contending with each other? When you have a large number of Go routines, are they having scheduling issues? Are they having problems with excess GC being run? Is there excess memory allocation? Right? If you allocate a large amount of memory, it's going to put pressure on the GC, on the garbage collector, and that takes more time to run. So is there a way of reducing that? One of the, this guy, Bill Kennedy, who's written this book called Go in Action, and he also runs Arden Labs and all that. He had talked, I think it was two or three months ago, he had come down, he had done a talk at the Google office. I don't know if any of you attended that. So that was an intense thing about looking at profiling, tracing, and then trying to optimize code. So he went over the steps by which he completely, fully occupied every code that was in place and therefore made his code better. I'll skip through these because I had covered all of them earlier. We also looked at, in tracing GC, there are ways in which you can set, you know, how many should be used. There are cases when you should set the number of, you know, parallel processors that your code should be running on, yeah, or concurrent rather. And you have various values that you can set, which will give you different results. So we saw the profiling data for that. This was some of the output from the talk that I did last time. There's also an environment variable called GoGC, which allows you to say when should you want your garbage collector kick in. Yeah, this is not something you should ideally fiddle around with, but it will show you, give you an idea of when GC kicks in. If there's an extreme or end case that you want to apply it for, you can do that. So the graph you see, the orange or peach color one is the heap memory. You can see that sawtooth graph. Every time that memory is allocated and garbage collector kicks in, it cleans out the memory and then it creates a sawtooth edge. Yeah, and then again starts allocating more memory and then garbage collector kicks in, goes on. Having covered all of that last time, we also looked at stack and heap. Again, you covered a bit about how to look at escape analysis. Right, there are certain data that is stored in the stack and something. Did you cover this? You didn't cover this? Okay, so maybe this is something that we can quickly talk about. Where is it preferable? There's no actually real answer for this. But why would you want variable allocated in stack as opposed to heap? Any idea? GC, what about the GC?
State, they will put on register also.
Sorry?
If it is on state, they will take on the register also.
I think one of the key things was the GC thing. Basically, the idea that, yes, you're right, you know, that when you allocate stuff on the stack, when once a function call finishes, the stack is cleaned up anyway, right? So there's nothing left for the GC to work on. But if something is there on the heap, then it puts garbage collection, there's pressure on the garbage collector, you can clear up stuff. And there's also, remember that when the garbage collector kicks in, it's dependent on how much memory available. So typically when you set a go GC equal to 100, it kicks in at the time where it has increased back to the amount where it ran the last time. So if it ran last time, let's say 1 MB of memory, okay, 1 MB is not where it is, but as an example, and it clears it, let's say it went down to 10 KB and again came back to 1 MB, it'll start the GC again. Right? So the more allocations that you do, it's going to run the GC more and more, in which case time goes away. When you run GC, it's part of your, it's running on the CPU, right? So it's time taken away from your program running, and therefore reducing that allows you to have more performance. Sorry? No. Specifying the memory. From the last time that the GC ran, if it ran when the memory was at 1 MB usage, next time it comes back to 1 MB usage, it will run GC again. So it's based on a memory benchmark, not a time. It doesn't say run the GC every 5 seconds. It says depending on memory usage. If more has been used, then let the GC.
I thought you were asking about the
No, it's not like. I think you've got a good point, actually. You know, it's and almost always in the example that I've run, that seems very like the cadence is very similar, but it might be because of the specific samples you're taking, right? Yeah, in my graph, you're right. No, it's not on time interval, it is based on memory usage. Yeah, but you're right, maybe I should be trying to add to see when that kicks in, I should add some kind of delay and see next time does it take a longer thing for it. Yeah, so the graph is one of the other, yeah, go ahead. Not much at all. Not much at all. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So in the examples we've taken very simple examples, right? And there's no variation in terms of time. So I have to simulate some amount of delay or different amount of allocation to see a alternate sawtooth graph. In this example, the ones that I've shown, I've copied some merge sort code from, from the guide. So it's quite consistent. The second part, I think, is, you know, when you see the GC, you know, it is not that it takes like a second or 2 seconds before the GC runs. It's usually every few hundreds of microseconds or something like that. Right? So it's not such a large gap also. More, almost anything you do will start allocating that kind of memory, I guess. But I'll try that out. I'll try that out and see if we can simulate a case where it's not showing a very specific pattern. But all the ones I've shown right now, you're right. You know. Yeah. I'll have to do something like that. In almost all cases, I've taken examples that also finish very quickly. I need to have examples that probably run much longer and then see the graph. The only thing is the amount of profiling information that comes from a program that runs for a certain amount of time is so large. It takes my, in fact, I noticed that my browser crashes, or at least the pprof tool, it crashes when I run some of the things for too long, because pprof generates a large amount of information. Like even for a second that it runs, it's got a lot of information. So I think I tried it and then backed off. That's actually, that happened quite a bit. I tried different things, but my browser would keep on hanging because it couldn't load the data. In newer versions, they're also doing this thing where they're not showing the full data, but they're showing only a few seconds. So if you profile for a large amount of time, it will show you for the first 1 second, then for the next two, another second, like that, you know, split into time, maybe for the same reason that you can't access the load. Any case, I take your input, and I'll try it out. Okay, what is the... So in case of the Go tooling, there's also the ability to find out where your memory is being allocated. Is it being allocated on the stack or the heap? Unlike C, C++, Java, it is not part of the, I think in those languages, it's part of the language specification that these things will go on, these things will go on stack, right? And you can be assured that will be the case. But when you really think about it, I ask these questions during some trainings that I do, other than people working in C, C++, who has really cared whether it goes on stack or heap? Right? Nobody does. JavaScript people, Python people, Java people, it really doesn't matter. The system takes care of it, right? And you just write your code and then go ahead. So Go allows you to see that difference and even maybe optimize your code and say, you know what, I don't want to put GC pressure. So I'll just allocate it in stack so that when the stack, when the function call returns, clear it off. Okay. There's tooling that allows you to do that escape analysis. Because pass by value, pass by reference is most to do with function calls. This is more to do with function return values. There's a difference there, but you can see it in the material. So in this particular talk, I just have mostly high-level points that I need to just walk you through and see some of the things that I have witnessed, all right? Many of them are very obvious, but then like I said, just to bring it to a conclusion. By the way, who did the second talk? I forget your name.
Agniva,
yeah. I haven't included this, but it was a very nice talk, right? And I would like to include that also as part of the optimizing thing. Agreed, these are all edge cases. You shouldn't be doing it all the time. You shouldn't be doing it all the time. But then again, it's something that I can include as part of the talk. So Agniva, is your talk also online somewhere?
No, I'll post this next.
Yes, please. No? I'll try to include. But also Ankur also gave me a few links because I said, okay, this seems interesting. I should add it to.
Cool.
Thank you.
Yeah,
he shared the same thing with me right now.
Oh, okay.
But I see some others also, so I'll add it to this wherever you go. So the one obvious thing that you need to do, especially when it comes to Go, is if you find that your work can be parallelized in a way that things don't have to be sequential, you parallelize it, right? And when you say parallelize it in Go, it means you make it concurrent. And I think those of, if you're part of the meetup, you already know what it is. I'm not going to talk about it too much. The example that I've given, I've taken it off the net in this case, is just creating a random string. When you're creating a random string based on a bunch of other things, there's really nothing that is going to contend for, right? There's no data that is commonly being accessed. And therefore, these kind of programs, they come under this thing called embarrassingly parallel, right? Is that the term for it? Have you heard about it? There are certain programs that are called embarrassingly parallel because you can just, as soon as you have more resources on which to apply it, it just works faster. Not everything can do that, right? For example, if you have multiple Go routines are trying to access one file or one database, there's a contention on that resource, right? So you can't parallelize. Even if you have a million virtual CPUs, you're still going to be restricted by the number of connections you have to the database. MySQL might give you 10 parallel connections, and that's all you can have. So you can't have any more. A program or an algorithm like this that has no resource contention can be embarrassingly parallelized, right? As many number of CPUs you have, you're able to get that much speed increase. So the first thing, of course, is if you have an option, see if you can parallelize it. By the way, even before this is we're just talking about Go. There are two approaches when you get to parallelization, right? Either or to improving your code. One is you look at doing all these small things in the language and say, can I get one microsecond increase there, one nanosecond increase. But those are usually the lesser of the approaches you should take. First, you should be looking at algorithmic change. Okay, algorithmic change bring you the maximum amount of benefit. So if you're applying a particular algorithm, see if there's a separate algorithm that gives you much faster output, irrespective of what kind of hardware you're running on, right? So first thing is always algorithm. Then only you can end up looking at all these things. Now, one thing I noticed, if you look at the output from this, when I ran the sequential one, it took me about 26, how many things is that, milliseconds or microseconds? Huh? No, 20, okay, that's 26 million nanoseconds, which is 26 milliseconds, right? About 26 milliseconds. And when I ran it concurrent, I got it to about a 3x improvement, which is considerable. So as soon as you parallelize it, provided it is parallelizable, you get more benefit. When I gave the same thing, now what I did was, in this line, if you see, I have added a time.sleep. Okay. I added time.sleep and I get a 3x improvement. But once I ran it, after removing the time.sleep, okay, now I've commented out the time.sleep, I ran the same thing. Now there is a 3x drop in performance. Okay. So one of the things you need to consider, of course, is one is that too much resource contention. Another thing in the case of Go is you need to consider what are called tight loops. The Go scheduler is able to work and make sure that these things are parallelizable and they can be, you know, allocated to different Go routines, provided at some point that function yields or it waits for something. Yeah. So it has to make something like a function call or like a time.sleep or it has to yield on its own in some way before the scheduler can actually use it, right? So it's the exact same code, but by just removing the time.sleep, my performance is actually worse, right? Where I got a 3x improvement, now it's got a 3x, it's worse by 3x. So know that you shouldn't be using extremely tight loops, where there's a small amount of code running very quickly in a loop, where it doesn't yield. There are no function calls being made. There are no blocking calls. There are no time.sleeps or whatever. Basically, those are not necessary things that you should include. But if there is a function call, then Go scheduler has a chance to say, I can move this from one Go routine to another Go routine, or I can take it and save the state to bring it back on later on. Yeah. If you can't do that, you will get tight loops, which will give you worse performance. So, two things to note when you're parallelizing. If you're working with contentious resources, where there's multiple Go routines trying to access the same resource, you have to look at benchmarking and see if there's a problem, right? Second thing is tight loops.
So this tight loops, it's not like that the Go scheduler will just take any Go routines and take the same code and
it can't. So in if you see, I don't know if I'm answering your question correctly, but if you guys know the internals of, not internals, if you just know how Windows or some of the other operating systems work, there is this thing called preemptive scheduling, right, at a thread level. It does not matter what state you are in, it will cut you off.
Yes.
Right? It will cut you off, but it will save the state so that next time you bring it back on, you're still okay. Go schedule apparently doesn't do that, right? There has to be certain points at which, only at certain points, is it able to take it out and in some way. Yeah. So tight loops kill that approach.
Tight loops can only happen when you are just working with basic data structure and doing some algorithms.
Probably. But then
as far as you have one at least library code also.
Yeah. Then it might yield to that. Yeah. So but then if you see, like you guys are talking earlier about optimizing. He's talking about optimizing for like a nanosecond, 2 nanoseconds by removing a bounce check. Right? Those come in like when you're doing like cryptographic code, like you're trying to make a hash function, right? It has to be very quick. And those might have some loops potentially. And that's where actually is where it's a big concern. For a lot of the code that we generally do as web services, this might not be a problem, right? But when you're doing core stuff, like low level stuff that you want to have high performance, then this could become an issue. For most web calls and all that, we are making a call to the database, you're calling some files, you're calling, it might not hit it. Fair enough. Another thing about tight loops is that if you start allocating memory within tight loops, it increases the GC pressure, right? A lot of things are being allocated very quickly, and therefore GC has to run longer. So again, you don't ideally do not allocate memory inside those type queues. One way to work with that is this thing called sync pools. Have you guys used sync pools? Any of you? So a sync pool allows you to not allocate memory or data every time you need to do that, right? From a pool, you allocate like a few items in the pool and then take it off the pool every time you want to use it, right? What is the downside? What are you giving up? With almost all these things, you are gaining something by giving up something. Yeah? Often it is that you give up complexity of code, I mean simplicity of code, to get higher performance, right? Like the example, Agniva. That you're making your code more complex, but you're eking out little bits of performance. So you're giving up something to get something else. In the case of sync pool, we allocate a few and then just take from that as and when you want to use it. Right? A simple example of this would be something like when you use a singleton, right? You've got only one instance of it. Every time you want to use that particular, that object, you call that one instance, right? So a pool like that has a pool of items that you pick from and put it back once you're done. So in this example, we are allocating some amount of memory inside our function. Okay. If you see the benchmark, in this I've also put a bench mem. The bench mem says there are 64 bytes being allocated per hour. When I use a sync pool, on the other hand, it is able to bring that down by about 4x. So in a lot of things, I'm not going to go through the code too much. It is just if you know, hey, these things are there, come back and refer and you should be fine. Right? So the idea of the sync pool again is you pre-allocate a certain number and then use from that as opposed to allocating it each time, which puts considerable pressure on them. Then sync once. Anybody heard of sync once? Sync once have you? Okay. In a lot of programs today, we need these backends to scale very quickly. Okay. So what happens is that when new traffic comes in, let's say we've gone from 10 users to a million users suddenly, we expand the backend very quickly, right? On Kubernetes, new pods come. So these pods or whatever new services, machines that come up, they start up very quickly. And this is the reason why languages like Java, .NET, Python and all, I don't like them, because you need to bring down a new image that has already got half a gig of the VM. Then you put your app on top of it. By the time you bring all of this up, you've lost precious seconds. When there are SLAs provided by, for example, I work with Google Cloud quite a bit. Their SLAs provided saying it will come up so quickly, right? You can't delay that. So if there are extensive initialization required when your application starts, it is going to slow you down. So one example is when you're using templates. When you're using templates, you need to load these templates off the file system, which itself is a very slow call. As soon as you have to call like file system, your speed reduces. From nanoseconds, it goes down to milliseconds, right? Not even microseconds. It goes down to milliseconds. So you're loading all these files. Now you're parsing the whole file to ensure that it's correctly formatted. And then you have it in memory in a compiled form. Right? So if you load all your templates at the beginning, and templates, for those of you who have not used templates, when you work with, say, any website, right, you could have each of the page is a template. An HTML page, you can have an HTML template in which you fill in your data. Right? So when you log in, it says, hey, some user. And if you are the user, it will fill in, hey, some Ramesh or Agniva or something like that. Right? So that loading process usually needs to be there before the rest of the code can run. But certain, if you say something like Facebook, or if you're bringing up an app on the Gojek website, right, you don't need to have every single page loaded. You can do it only at the time. Sorry. You need to only load that page, that template, at the time that you're first using it. Right? So you can do what is called lazy initialization. Instead of initializing everything in the beginning, which slows down your program startup time, you defer it until the point that you're going to use it for the very first time. Now the problem with that is once you wait until the very end, you don't know who's going to do this now, right? Does everybody have to do it? Like every person who's making that call, do they have to do it? An alternate is what is provided by sync.once, where the code inside the once.do function will only be called once ever, right? So even if you call that function a million times, only the very first time has it run. If at the very same time, 10,000 Go routines come and try to start the same Go routine for the very first time, even then, only one of them will pass. All the others will not go through. Okay. So sync.once creates a one-time mutex. I'm not using that term as a technical thing, but that's the analogy. A mutex, only one can run at a time. Within that, this is a sync.once allows only one of that to ever run. Right? You'll never have the initialization happening twice. So in this example, I have a template that is loaded. And you can see that when I run it, it took about 0.637 seconds for the entire program. This is not a benchmark. We are looking at the time it took for the program to start up and run. Okay. So we are doing time go run instead of doing a benchmark, and it's about a little more than half a second. The same thing I did by doing it at the very beginning. At the first time the program loaded, I load all my templates instead of loading it each time that the function kicks in. Yeah. So in that case, you can see that it's about 0.365. So this is not the example that I want to show you though. In this example, we are doing it once. So the problem with this is, even though my example shows only one template, ideally you will have probably maybe tens or hundreds of templates. Yeah. So it is going to be 0.365 into quite a few times, not just 0.365. Yeah. In the ideal implementation, we have what is called a sync.once, and that on that O is just an instance of sync.once. We are doing that call only once. So we are deferring it until the point that the function is called. Only the first time, we are calling it 10,000 times, but only once will o.do run. Okay, which means that your initialization doesn't happen all at the beginning. It is deferred and it happens only once. So this again, in this particular case, you can see that there is not much of a difference in the time it took to run, but that is because we've done only one template. Yeah? When you have larger number of templates, you're going to have way more time taken. I was wondering whether I should cover this at all. Do you guys know the difference between arrays and slices? If it is, then I can skip it. Yeah. So I'll just quickly go through it. So arrays in Go are fixed size immutable data. Okay. Slices are always backed by an array, but slices are mutable. Slices can grow. Go allows you anybody, maybe I can hear it from somebody. Why would we even have arrays and slices? Arrays and slices are very, very similar in the way it looks and the way it is run. But why do we have arrays and slices? Is there a difference? You know the internals of how slices are implemented? That's the question. Sorry? Who's saying that? So the slice is always backed by an array, and whenever the I've got small examples that will show that, but for time I'll just move on. The key reason why you're doing that is that because arrays are immutable, every time you try to append to an array, what you have to do is you have to reallocate new memory, right? So if you've got 10 items in an array and you want to add 11th item, you can't add it in place. Why can't you add it in place? Because an array has three features. What are three features of the array? One is it has to be homogeneous. Yeah, it has the same data type. It has to be indexed. And the third thing is it has to be sequential or contiguous in memory. Yeah. So when you try to expand an array, there is no guarantee that the next memory location is actually available. Right? It could be allocated to something else. So what the runtime has to do, or if you're doing C, C++, what you have to do is you have to allocate new memory that is equal to the earlier size plus the additional size, copy all the data, and then use that. So two things happen. One, this process of moving memory, right, is very, very, very costly. If you actually run it, you can see the difference. The second thing is it also puts considerable pressure on the garbage collector. Unlike C, you can't just say remove that memory, right? The one that is there is still there and it keeps adding to GC, right? It keeps adding to the heap. So the time it takes to append an array is very, very long. What slices give you is the ability to pre-allocate memory, right? So you're giving up something for something else. In this case, you're giving up space, memory space, that you're pre-allocating something that you can't currently use. So it's not available for others, but your performance increases by multifold. Yeah? So you're giving up space and memory in a pre-allocated situation to get way higher performance. So you will see that you can try it out. You can try it out. Yeah? Slices have become so good right now that other languages are trying to adopt that approach. Most other languages don't have that as an inbuilt data structure. They only have arrays and all that. Other languages are not trying to do that. And almost anywhere in Go, they try to use slices to start. When I started working in Go long back, slices are one that completely confused me, because I started using slices like they were addicts. They're looking the same. I'm like, okay, just the same thing. And I got completely confused by it. And I got a lot of errors that I couldn't debug. The way it is passing data, the way it was using data, how it was expanding, extending. So, where possible, in the case of slices, reallocate memory. If you know the number of months, let's say you're taking a count of how many people have birthdays in a particular month, right? So all months need not be there. What we could do is every time I ask someone, he says his birthday is in March, so I add March to my array, right? And then somebody says in January, then I append, create a new array and append to that. So every allocation costs a lot, right? And you shouldn't be doing that. If you pre-allocated your size, saying, you know what, I know maximum, this can go to a length of 12. There aren't more months than 12, right? So pre-allocate 12 as a size of the slice of months, then your code becomes much faster. But you might not, like for example, we might have say a November or a September not as part of the list. So we've lost that one or two spaces in memory, but we are willing to give that up to get high performance. In the same way, strings could be considered like an array of characters, right? And strings are immutable. If you come from a Java background, you know that you're not supposed to concatenate the strings. You have to do that. It's the same thing over here. If you concatenate the strings, this is what is happening. The memory is being reallocated in a separate place. Data is being copied and then appended over there, which means the pressure on the CPU and memory is very, very, very high. The two options, there is something called string buffer and string builder. When I saw the benchmarks that I run before, the string builder and the string and the bytes buffer, sorry, the bytes buffer and the string builder, they had almost the same time. But I think there have been optimizations made since then, and now the string builder seems to be much faster, right? Almost 5 times faster than bytes buffer. So again, do your benchmarks. But it looks to me, for whatever it is, I didn't see why it was doing faster, but the same code, not same code, something similar code, somebody had done a benchmark. It was like 128 nanoseconds, 10 nanoseconds, and 10 nanoseconds. Yeah. But now it is like 10 and about 2.5 or something. So the string builder seems to be much faster, but maybe for some specific use cases also. How much more time do I have, Praveen? Another 10 minutes? Okay. I think this one is obvious. If you're having a map, try to use an int as your key, not a string. Because what is happening, it's doing a hash, the process of doing a hash is there, and then doing the comparison. But I was wondering also on this, for the int also, if you're doing a hash map, you still need to do a hash, right? So I don't know what the internal implementation is. I need to see this here. But in any case, if you have the option of doing a map with a string and then being able to convert it to an int of some sort, then use the int, you're getting much higher performance. One thing I got when I was doing my testing again was, I expected that irrespective of the length of the string, I was going to have fairly consistent access times for the map itself. But I saw that the longer the string is, the access times are actually increasing quite a bit. Right? So that was another surprising outcome for me. So a lot of us have, like for example, you have map of a name, right? Map of first name, and then we give that person's identity or something. So if you're doing it like for a simple name, it's okay. But if you ran the code in say India, may work. If you take it to some Saudi Arabia and there's some guy whose name is some Abdullah, Jilla, Abdullah, and goes on for long, you know, for like a novel, then you're going to have much different values in terms of performance, because it seems that the hash on the string that is longer is way higher than smaller ones. Yeah. But even there, try to use ints over strings. When you're doing file I/O, there are two ways you can do it, either buffered or unbuffered. In the case of buffered, what happens is that, from what I understand, I don't know the internals very well, but just through my research, I mean, whatever I'm reading online. When you do buffered I/O, what happens is that instead of making a call to the operating system every single time, which happens in the case of unbuffered, it is queuing up some of the data. So you're making, let's say, five calls or whatever, when the data is being read, it is not being read every byte or something that you're going to read. It's reading larger blocks, putting together in some intermediate space, and then giving it. Yeah. The difference between unbuffered and buffered was significant. Okay. I think it's like what 220 times or what. So if you use if you're trying to do W dot write, when you start writing code, ideally this is how you just start writing F dot write string or F dot write, you know, some handle dot write is what you normally start doing. Okay. When I change it to a buff IO, like I said, it's gone from 882 milliseconds down to 4.5 milliseconds. That's a significant change when you do buffer IO. So if you have the option to do that, do that. In the process of buffer IO, apparently there are also different levels. The operating system might provide a buffer, your runtime might provide a buffer, and what is the other one? There's at the hardware level also, the disk level also, there might be a buffer, right? So all of them, imagine if you were able to get the benefit of all of them accumulated into your program. That's what we are seeing in the output. I think this one is fairly straightforward. If you have to use any kind of comparison, regex should be a last choice. But if there is a choice, I mean, if there is an absolute requirement to do a regular expression parsing, pre-compile it. Yeah? So the difference between a compiled version and one that you run each time, again, it's of the order of 10, 12. In another blog post, I saw a bunch of these small items. Some of them have gone into a little deeper. Some of them I didn't. But you can see other ideas on improving your performance, yeah, optimizing your code. I spoke about this. If you allocate memory in hot code, or what are called tight loops, you're going to have significant pressure on the GC. Try not to do that. Yeah, maybe allocate it outside, like in a sync pool, and then use that. Favor lock-free algorithms. Like I said, algorithm efficiency gives you the maximum benefit, as long as you have some resource that are being contended for by 10 or 20 go routines or more, each of them are having to wait, right? And that's a bad idea. So try to create algorithms that, or try to work with algorithms that have no contention, okay? Or that favor lock-free algorithms. It's the same. Use read-only locks. If you're using mutexes, there is something, a regular mutex and what is called a RW mutex. So a mutex is when there's one data that you want to access, or rather a section of code that you want to access. A mutex will allow only one go routine to go through it at one point in time. Yeah. If you use an RW mutex, it will have all the reads can go through parallel, but the writes will stop. Right. So which means that only at the time that the data is changing, you're blocking it out, but all the other times read can happen way in parallel. If you see maps are not go routine safe originally. Yeah. But I think from version 1.10 onwards, if you try to write to a map simultaneously, Go itself throws an error. Have you guys tried this out? I didn't try it out. With any of the new versions, tried it out. The earlier versions, it wasn't there. You were allowed to write to maps in parallel. It was not a good idea, right? It was not a good idea, but it allowed you to do that. Since 1.10, it throws an error. It doesn't crash your program, but at least outputs an error to standard error, sharing, at least informing you that you're trying to access your data in parallel. We looked at reallocated mutex.
Mutex, R is greater than RW.
So there was some contention about this, okay? In some of the earlier documentation that I read, so in general, this makes sense, right? If you're doing a regular mutex, everything is locked, right? Whether you do a read or write, it's going to be locked. The RW mutex, if you just do a read, it allows all reads to go in parallel, but writes are blocked one by one. Yeah? And while the write is happening, the reads also won't happen. So it is recommended to do that as a general principle. But I also did see that there was some implementation issue with RW mutex some time back. Okay, I haven't seen what happened to that bug or issue after that. So I won't give you a complete answer on that. I will just say you'll have to check the document. But more often than not, allow multiple reads, but constrain your writes. That won't happen. That won't happen. When write happens, only write happens. It's a
Yes.
Yes.
only for the right time. Right? Until then only it will and then it will wait the right will wait for the lead to then right will extremely low.
Right will be wait for that.
Basically, it might, but I honestly do not know how it's implemented internally. It's a question that came to me earlier, and I didn't see the implementation to see how it is actually done. Right? There is potentially, like you said, there are a million reads and one write. But maybe it has to drain all the writes, all the reads before the write happens. Or maybe it, you know, it does something else. Now, if you see another documentation for the select keyword in Go, you'll see that even if there are multiple things coming at the same time, the way it is selected is what we call a pseudo-random fashion. Right? So, there is no guarantee from what I understand, but I'm not sure about this, that even if there are a million reads, it's going to execute in that order. Right? It will, by way of pseudo-randomness, ensure that everybody gets something. Which is?
Instead of that, what you have the concept of, okay, let's suppose there are five coroutines trying to access that, right? So if the coroutine which is currently running, it's hot on CPU also, it does not have context switching, right? So it will, there is high probability of chance that that coroutine will get the access to the mid-text instead of the coroutine which is getting it.
Okay.
But the how they attend this unclear scheduling is there is one millisecond. When millisecond of time slice. So if any coroutine means that this you know this mid-text is blocked for more than 1 millisecond, it make it in a non-emitting mode and this scheduled. So it will make so that the coroutine from the schedule that means you will directly get access to it. So that's how they keep the balance. The coroutine that is still pending.
So I don't know the internal implementation. He knows that better. I'm sure there's documentation on it, but I haven't read. I don't think there has been too much of a complaint around this, right? Maybe the algorithm he used that he's saying it does, or like the select keyword, it uses a pseudo random approach that it is not based on necessarily time that you enter, right? It's based on somebody will get it, but you don't know that. Like it's like when you access keys from a map, you don't get in the same order that you went in or something. It's some order. But you do get it in some fashion. I may not have a complete answer to what you're asking. You'll have to look at the internal. Then, of course, you know, in terms of using certain serialization, he'd done a benchmark. I didn't want to talk about it over here, but he did a comparison of you know marshalling, unmarshalling JSON, and marshalling, unmarshalling all the protobuf things, and the protobuf things was proving to be much faster. And there's something called message pack also. I've never used it. I don't know if you guys have heard of something called message pack. So I don't know that. But again, message pack or protobuf seem to be much faster than using JSON if you're looking for optimization. Remember, a lot of this, you're giving up something or something else. JSON is very easy to understand and read. Yeah. So my first suggestion, if you want to make it work and ensure that it works and you can demonstrate to people what is being passed or not, maybe start with JSON, right? And then shift to protobuf if you think you're sure. Okay, guys. So I will stop with that, hopefully on time. And you can access this at this GitHub. Like I said, there's been a lot of work that I've put into it over many months. Come on, that's the end of this. The code will be there. I hope to continue to add to it. I'm going to add the what do you call it? The bounce checking and any other things that I see. I saw a lot, like I said, it's just that there was so much information to capture and to actually understand it. The other problem I had was what they were saying was a problem like a few years ago. It's not a problem anymore, right? They're showing these results and I'm not seeing those results because the compiler or the runtime has been optimized to actually take care of that. So now none of those examples are valid. Now there are newer things. One of the other good places that you can go is a workshop.